So I guess, I don't know, like, do we have anything else to say?
I think that's about it. Yeah, if you want to go back and check out the previous interview, we basically went over what we're gonna do today. We went over the previous year's data and the preseason analysis
Yeah,
that
because
he gave us.
that was back then when he had just released the
Yeah, the
preseason, like,
preseason analysis. Yeah,
which,
that's right.
by the way, held pretty well throughout the year.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So those observations that he got there from those testing labs, for some reason, dictated some of what was going to happen. It's incredible. It's
Yeah.
incredible. And that's what, well, I mean, people do tend to say that in the world of F1, like, oh, by Spain, you get an idea of how the year is going to go. But still, on like, on a sport that I guess on that end is like kind of predictable,
Yeah.
it still was such an unpredictable year. So
That's right.
we gotta talk to him about the nuances of that as well. And I think without further ado, if Mike, you can get going to establish a direct line to
Let's do
Dr.
it.
Phillips.
Gonna call him through Skype here.
Yeah.
So excuse us for 1 second while rings through the internet. And here we go.
Hey guys.
Hey, how's it going?
Dr. Phillips.
Good afternoon. Good
How are you
morning.
doing?
I guess, yeah, it's good morning to
Good
you,
morning for
right?
you, right?
Yeah, morning here in
Good day,
Australia.
mate.
Don't insult the man. Jesus, Danny.
Sorry. Sorry.
So you are talking to us from the future, essentially.
Yep.
Because it is Monday there right now. How's the I mean, because I did a quick
It's
search.
about 8 a.m.,
Yeah.
7 a.m. there.
And at 7 a.m., I can guarantee you, I know that you did this, like, you're in Australia right now. I don't know your exact reasons, but I can tell you right now that you made a good decision, because right now in Boston is minus six.
Yeah.
It looks bright and sunny where you are.
Weather-wise, definitely better here. And I'm a little bit closer to the 2017 season.
Yeah, that's true. That's
Very
true.
true, very true.
Are you gonna be hanging around there for the next 76 days?
Sadly, no.
When was the last
Yeah.
Australian Grand Prix that you went to?
99, I think.
Oh yeah.
Oh,
That's a crazy one.
It's been a while.
No doubt. So I guess, yeah, you'll be going back to Boston at some point, but until then, you're just enjoying the nice weather. Looking forward to 2017.
Very much. Yeah, I'd be very keen to catch a race this year. I think it's going to be crazy.
Yeah, I'm excited. I can't wait to see these cars. The unveils are coming in the next 5 6 weeks. I'm gonna see
Yeah.
them all on the test track.
So, I guess, like, there's no need to. We just did a quick introduction about your work with F1Metrics. The infamous tweet from Alonso. How did that, like, how did you find that? That was pretty cool.
It definitely boosted the views of
I can't imagine how, like, how was
bet.
that spike, like, from like down here to the thousands?
Yeah, it pretty much quadrupled the views of that
Nice.
post.
Wow.
That's
That's beautiful.
fantastic. That's amazing. Like,
Oh, it deserves it anyway.
great insight. And we were just saying how the last time we talked to you was after the preseason testing, and we went through your preseason analysis and how, by and large, it pretty much held throughout the year in terms of teams, especially, obviously, like, we but I guess we sort of, all of us in the back of our minds, we knew that it was going to end up being Mercedes at the top,
Yeah.
and the order to follow.
Perhaps not
Yeah.
fourth India.
That's true.
Yeah, Force India definitely. Well, I'd say they started the season close to how they looked in testing, but then they really just improved massively across the year.
Now, yeah, you made that point during your now the 2016 form analysis, how they were basically one of the best performing cars in the year. And that, to me, was almost shocking, because in terms of bringing tons of parts to every weekend, they weren't really known for that. They didn't do a ton of that. They mostly just kept quiet, kept the design kind of similar to last year, and just, I guess, worked on fine-tuning the details.
The nostrils, that was the only real
But that
head,
was
that
from
was the
last
only
year.
the only headline upgrade that they had, right?
But that no, that was from last
That
year. But
yeah,
like from the year before,
that's what I'm
even.
saying. That's like the last really headline upgrade that they had.
What do you
Just
what do you make of it?
Well, I think it's a couple of things. One is they have a lot of suppliers,
Yeah.
So for one thing, you know, obviously the alliance with Mercedes helps. They use other people's wind tunnels. You know, they get parts from a lot of other teams in a way similar to Haas. The other thing which I was reading recently is apparently they have a very specific design philosophy in which they don't even let their designers work on certain areas of the car. They say, you know, unless there's, you know, some predicted gain larger than a threshold, then just don't even waste your time on that area of the car. So they only work in areas where there's potential high gain in terms of aerodynamics.
Which must be, I mean, you as a statistics guy that is interested in that field, like, how do you, the models that they might use to, like, figure out even if one way of design versus another is going to yield that much must be, I mean, you're spending all night figuring that out even.
Yeah, it would be a very complicated optimization problem.
Yeah, it's got to be arbitrary in itself, just figuring out what to work on.
But hey, it's worked for them, so clearly they're onto something. Yeah. Is that your, like, your biggest, I guess, like, shock this year, or biggest surprise to see how they kept going and kept improving despite the limited resources?
I would say so. Yeah. Renault, I think, were also a bit of a surprise in just how bad they were.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I kind of went in with low expectations for them, but then from testing times, I thought they'd be a little bit more competitive, and then they were just never there. They were always hanging around the back.
And that was something that really shocked everyone, because they came into the year saying that they were super committed to F1, but then not backing that up on track. At the same time, you could
say
they
came into the program for this year, though, late.
Yeah.
And they said this year was kind of a throwaway year. They want to balance the behind the scenes, the organization, the office work, all that stuff before they're going to perform on track. But
yeah, I think it makes perfect sense for them to focus on 2017. 2016 was always going to be kind of a lost year for them. It was just a question of how bad.
Right. For looking at your data, though, so this is probably a little bit unorthodox. I don't want to go too deep just off the top here, but just because you mentioned the Renault, if you add the two drivers' performance numbers for the year, right?
The PPRs?
I just saw your eyebrows raise. If you add them, though, you can kind of get an idea of the team performance, and Renault comes out second last.
They
come out right at the bottom, 8.39.
Yeah,
which is not too far below Alonso on his own.
Yeah, basically. So Sauber, they were just ahead of. And I couldn't get a rating on Manor, given their drivers were not connected.
Right, yeah.
So probably they were the third last. Yeah. I think that's pretty accurate.
So a crazy thing just happened. Actually, I don't know, like if you guys read about it, but Manor again in administration.
Yes. Well, they're dead basically.
It's
looking like they're not going to race this year.
Yeah, but it's looking final now. Now I about that Manor push, because I think obviously losing that, like you pointed out on your blog too, like losing that 10th place to Sauber, disaster. Total disaster, because when they were fishing for investors, at one point it was even said that Ron Dennis and a team led by Graham Loudon were looking into maybe, but obviously they would have been counting on the whole transportation agreements that would have come with the 10th place and the prize money 100%.
Yeah.
So now that that's all gone, poor them. Like I would actually really like to see Manor come back next year, but 2 years in administration.
Yeah, don't forget
starting the year in administration.
We started talking about last week, and I wanted to expand on this week, but the deal fell through. Was that there was an Asian conglomerate of businesses that were going to take over the Manor team and reform it into some sort of an Asian team that fell through, and. Yeah, it's just dead. That's it.
It's sad to see, because you want to see more teams in F1.
Don't forget, for this season, in 2015, at the end of 2015, going into the 2016 season, they were given by the FOM a special sort of dispensation that they were allowed to use the old chassis. And with the new nose regulations, they put in some sort of spacer piece there to conform with that. And they're using an old engine that they weren't getting any support for, aside from Wehrlein being a Mercedes driver.
Yeah.
They're basically on strings the whole year. They have less than 200 employees, where Mercedes has 1,300. You have to put an asterisk beside their name.
And
Harry Anto's backers pulled out halfway through the season.
Well, I mean,
yeah, they did.
Who could blame him?
Exactly. Yeah.
But what do you see the minor situation going like? Is like, are they salvageable? Like, is that a team? Because they kind of did.
Sadly, I think they're not, because you know it's not like last time where they were able to turn up with sort of a year old car and still have something that was roughly legal. They really do need to build a car from scratch for this year. And if they, you know, by all accounts, they haven't made much progress there because the team's probably going under. So to design a whole new car before Australia.
Yeah.
And then to get it anywhere near 107% when you're going into a totally new formula. And then even to live on, I mean, it's kind of inevitable that this will happen, right? We've got a prize fund structure that only really supports 10 teams.
Yeah.
So whoever's in 11th is always going to be under the hammer. You know, if it's not Manor, it'll be Sauber. If it's not Sauber, it'll be Haas.
It's like that for a reason. You also don't want to... You don't want to give every single or at least that's the motivation behind that. You don't want to give every single team, regardless of whether they come in for one race or whatever, a piece of the pie, because some people say that wouldn't encourage competition.
Competition, right?
That aside, though, very sad. It would be very sad to lose Manor, because we had a couple of years where there were only 10 teams, and just having that extra team, like that extra bit of traffic going around, it helps. Like it gives people opportunities to make maneuvers. It is good for the sport to have more teams in general. Like even if they're just barely scraping the 107%.
I agree. I mean, when I started watching, it was usually closer to 30 cars. The 26 was sort of the standard in the early 90s.
Jesus.
It felt like a busier, more colorful, more vibrant grid.
Absolutely.
Of course, you know, by the end of the race, many of those cars were not running because of the reliability at the time. But at least early in the race, the grid looked packed.
There still is a chance for Manor for 2018 to pull through. Somebody throughout this next year could come through with the money, build the team up, and say, like, look, now we have another year and a half. Let's build a car that we can compete in 2018 with.
Absolutely.
It's still possible. Like, there were, up until a few days ago, and 3 or 4 days ago, there was a group of people who were about to drop the money and take control of it. They backed out in the last minute, but hey.
That'll be a story that, I mean, I hope it's not as sad as it seems, but, you know, maybe not this year, maybe by 2018, they'll figure it out and we'll be able to rescue the teams and facilities, because the facilities, you know, regardless of what they
that's
do,
what I'm saying. That's already,
the big computers are still going to be there.
That stuff is already set
their
up.
Their autoclave is going to be there. Whatever their composites department, as rudimentary as it might be, is still going to exist somewhere physically in the UK. So hopefully somebody will come in with some money and rescue them, you know, pull them out of the grave. Going back to, you know, the first thing that we're here for, really, the 2016 model-based driver rankings. I just wanted to go, if we can go like quickly one by one and talk about how you saw the season, in this frame rate of, like, you know, we were discussing about, you know, talking about inter-team rivalries, some battles, significant stuff that happened throughout the year. I think that despite how predictable-ish it was, in the sense that you knew that a Mercedes was going to win most of the time, it was still an incredibly unpredictable season, an incredibly surprising season, and we have some great stories.
I love that even though the three Manor drivers have the asterisk beside their name because the mix-up, some of them didn't complete a bunch of races, that Gutierrez is still by far by a measurable amount the lowest ranked driver in Gutierrez, 2.53 points per race.
Yeah, that's rough. I mean, it...
the moving blue flag himself.
He had some bad luck, but should he be in Formula One? Probably not.
This is what we've been saying, man. This is what we've been saying. Yeah. And obviously, like, my arguments or arguments here are usually, like, who can scream the loudest. But
Carlos Slim clearly has too much money. He's too much money.
But no, it absolutely based on nothing, like the kind of facts that you put behind putting Esteban Gutierrez in 23 here. You just know, like, you look at the guy and there's no, like, you don't get any passion from seeing him drive. You just, like, you watch him on a Grand Prix weekend, and more often than not, you're annoyed when he comes on the screen. Like, you know, no, seriously.
Yeah, kind of ruins your day for a bit.
Yeah.
Guy that shouldn't be there.
Yeah.
Like, it should actually be, if F1 wants people, especially, like, new fans and people that, the kind of stuff that they should be doing, they should be trying to get the numbers up in terms of audience, and especially new audience. If they want to be taken seriously by any new viewer, they can't have drivers that are just so far below what the best drivers of the world should be. And that's something I think that it's detrimental to the sport. At a certain point, you gotta make a decision of whether or not, like, just having a pile of money behind you should actually give you a seat.
That's true, but I mean, it has always kind of been that way. And I'd say Gutierrez is a lot better than the very worst drivers we've ever seen in Formula One.
And don't forget about Lance Stroll.
Well, I mean, that's the other side of the coin, I would like to think.
Canadians with money are okay. they're cool.
What do you... actually, speaking of that, let's take a break from here. What do you... Because you also did a fantastic analysis of the junior drivers... future prospects into Formula One. That's another amazing read for anybody that hasn't yet. We'll put the links in the description. But where do you... I saw that you gave Lance Stroll like an excitement... What is it? Excitement rating? Excitement... What do you call it? Excitement something. The excitement score of 18. And the... Yep. Compare that to Leclerc... as being like the most exciting guy at 28. Yep. That's a full 10 points. Yet
it's solid though.
It's solid, but I agree with this. I've been saying Leclerc, fantastically exciting guy. Like his 1 year in Formula 3, like, he basically destroyed any other rookie, constantly rookie of the year. He's an exciting guy, but he's not in Formula 1. For some sort of reason, like, he could be like, I think he has a rightful claim to be in Formula One more so than Gutierrez, if he ever, like, made it, but just as rightful a claim as Lance Stroll. And I don't think the fact that he doesn't have as much money as Lance Stroll is what's stopping him, because he has the Ferrari machine behind him.
Yeah, I think with Leclerc, you know, he's obviously one of the most promising drivers in this junior generation. Mm-hmm. So, you know, why rush things, I think, is their view.
True.
You know, put him into GP2, develop him for another year or two, and then bring him in.
That's actually a solid argument. Mm-hmm. Now, on the other side, when we were just talking, Lance Stroll, what do you see of him? Like, how do you think he's actually going to perform? Let's say things don't move from where they are right now, and he ends up being stacked against Valtteri Bottas, strong driver. How do you see that, that battle there going, if it stays that way?
My prediction is he'd be beaten by Bottas. Okay. I don't think he'd embarrass himself. I mean, so he is coming in from Formula 3, which is a relatively big jump, but he's not the first driver to do that. And by all accounts, he's getting an unusual amount of mileage under his belt before he comes into Formula 1. Mm-hmm. He's clearly quite talented. I don't know if he's the most talented among his generation, but he clearly has scope for improvement. Like, we saw from his first to his second Formula 3 season was a massive step forward. Mm-hmm. We'll see. It's always hard to predict how someone will do in Formula 1, but I think he has a perfectly respectable junior career. I mean, he probably wouldn't be in Formula 1 this year without as much financial support as he has. Mm-hmm. But I'm not too concerned that he's on the grid.
But yeah. Don't forget, well, for everybody, that his dad paid for him to go, like you just said, to a bunch of F1 tracks with a F1 car with about 20 men to make the car work. bought the team a new simulator.
Yeah.
Definitely bought a duplicate simulator for the house, for at home. He has the same one. Absolutely 2-for-1 deal. And whatever else comes along the way, like all kinds of photo shoots, magazine articles, headlines, etc. Just pushing his name out there. Getting that contract done. I think that's potentially
a pretty big edge in Formula One. When you consider how limited testing is now. Mm-hmm. You know, it's very unusual compared to most sports, you know, where people train week, you know, day on day for hours and hours. I mean, how do you train for a Formula One race? Like, you don't go and drive a Formula One car, usually. Because testing is so limited.
Yeah, if you
look at the simulator is kind of the next best thing, and I think drivers who are taking advantage of that may be keeping themselves a little bit sharper these days.
Have you with these new cars? Have you noticed any difference, like, in like the way that some drivers? Because we were talking about this, I think, off air another time that we just got together, and the video game generation, the people that were born, you know, when like sort of realistic video games were around, you know, we're talking about people that grew up in the late 90s, early 2000s,
playing for the last decade now.
Yeah, for their whole lives.
Modern games, yeah.
Like, do they have a sort of an advantage, or at least when it comes to like doing this for like 70 times a lap, you know, with the buttons and whatever. Like, do you think that, like, I mean, this is completely objective.
Are you doing that hand thing?
Yeah, doing the hand thing all the time. Do you think that makes a difference? I mean, I've kind of noticed like that. Maybe some of the old school guys, they kind of have to not necessarily drive differently, but you know, their steering wheels look less complicated. If you look at, especially the top teams, how they customize.
Yeah, absolutely. With multitasking. That's the new generation.
Yeah, that's interesting. I haven't noticed that. But yeah, I do really think time spent in sim racing at this point is definitely going to be an advantage to people, and it's probably going to become a major route for entry into racing categories just because it's so much more economically efficient.
Well, the FIA just not too long ago, a couple months ago, they released like a virtual super license or some sort of, so they're actually instituting, yeah, for people that race in just video games, that their career is like competitive video gaming, they're going to start to institute some sort of a license because they see a value there. They think that at least, not necessarily everything, but some of the skill that you need to be a racing driver, be it like things like you said, like, yeah, like being able to control the wheel or whatever, like the sim part of it, but also some of the racecraft, you can just as easily learn in a virtual environment as a real environment, probably.
A set of course, R factor, those type of things. But what you were just saying, if you look now, like this is Danny Rick, if you look at a bunch of these drivers' Instagrams and Twitters, they're all posting pictures of themselves like boxing athletes, lifting weights and stuff the past couple of weeks now. Like, I follow because of this for this podcast. Look, there's Danny Rick just lifting weights. I guess they're concerned that these cars are gonna test them more.
Well, right? that's the other thing that's coming. Yeah, 2017. But is there actually like any like real basis for that fear that like they're actually gonna be that much like tougher on your body?
Yes, man. You've never felt 5 Gs in your life.
Yeah, no, I guess not.
You've never felt that. Imagine if you weighed 1,000 pounds for a few seconds, even. You'd be like, oh, that sucked. Yeah, imagine that. That would suck. They'd do that, you know, like 50 laps in a row. Over and over again.
I guess, you know what? Let's get into 2017 after. We were taking too many tangents now. But going back to the analysis, so to Esteban Gutierrez, Rio Haryanto, let's not even touch on that because, yeah, he wasn't there. Jolyon Palmer, right at the bottom of the list with those three. Couldn't agree more. We've been saying this all year. He hasn't impressed. Like, I'm actually quite surprised that he retained his contract.
I'm quite surprised he got a contract in the first place, really. I mean, well, you know, I don't have anything against him, but yes, GP2 champion on paper, but after 4 attempts, and in 3 of those attempts, he was getting beaten by his teammates. He wasn't competitive. And that was sort of the story of his junior career. He was never very competitive.
Not even
until he stayed for a long time in one series.
I saw this on the article and I just couldn't stop laughing, man. His dad owns a racing series and he finished 10th in it.
Yeah.
So,
the one saving grace for him is he only spent 1 year in go-karts, which is practically unheard of for a Formula One driver today.
Yeah.
Usually, they're starting around the age of 5, or at least starting competitive races around the age of 8.
Yeah.
And, he did 1 year at like 14 and then went straight to cars. Fair enough. he's missing a sort of a chunk of experience that's just sort of standard for Formula One drivers these days.
Yeah.
But, is that a reason to keep him on the grid? I don't think so.
Interestingly, him and his teammate beat each other the same amount of times, though. 8-8.
Yeah, which frankly doesn't look good for Magnussen.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. Yeah, yeah. That actually looks bad for Magnussen.
Bad for, yeah.
Not good for Jolyon.
Yeah.
Say what you will about their car and whatever. The Renault, how atrocious of a season they had. And starting from the back, there's not much that you can do if you're at that level. But I think I had more higher hopes with Magnussen. I gotta be honest with you. I thought that Magnussen was a solid driver, like when he got to McLaren at the very beginning. Yeah. But such is life. And the next one was the next driver up to 20, Nico Hülkenberg. Another massive disappointment in a way, because is it now time? Yeah. To stop talking about Nico Hülkenberg as being the guy that deserves a seat
in the platinum license.
Yeah, Mr. Platinum License. Is it time now to finally stop talking about that and like just hold him accountable to whatever his talent is and see what he's actually going to be able to do?
Yeah. I guess so. I mean, I guess his hope is that, in the new formula we're seeing this year, I mean, the cars will be substantially different. Maybe that will somehow be suited better to his style. Because the weird thing about Hülkenberg is he's just been so quick in everything except Formula One.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's where it counts, though, kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At first, like when these new cars, since 2014, when the new regulations were brought in, you kind of gave him a pass because he was too tall. He was too big, the biggest driver. So that could have given him an unfair disadvantage. So you had to look at his achievements in that lens. But then time kept moving.
Well, there's also sort of a problem I have with that excuse, which is that he's always looked extremely good over one lap. Like in qualifying, he's always beating his teammates. He's always got a good time advantage there. And if it were a pure weight time disadvantage, you'd expect that really to show up in qualifying particularly. But instead, he has this edge in qualifying and then he just doesn't seem to manage his races as well as his teammates. I would tend to put that down to sort of a poor understanding or poor management of the Pirelli tire.
Perez, his teammate this year, is reckoned by some people to be one of the best at doing that, at managing the tires.
Right.
Yeah, Perez came into his own this year.
In a way, yeah.
Yeah.
He really matured as a driver. You can look tell.
At his races and points for the year by your numbers here. He's like 130, 140% over Hülkenberg for the season.
Yeah, he did very well.
Counting the races they finished, yeah.
Now, Hülkenberg also was part of the center of one of the biggest stories of the late part of the season, which was obviously his signing with Renault, with the works team that a lot of people, including yourself, are saying that it's probably the smartest move from him. I honestly agree, because if he's going to be able to actually prove now to all of us that he is a worthy, platinum license holder and worthy of all the praise that we've been giving him, he ought to be able to prove that in a
Renault. He should be able to lead a works team to a championship.
Yeah. Or close enough anyway before his career.
And we said last week too, Renault promised Red Bull now engine parity. So there's no excuse anymore for Red Bull beating Renault, right?
Yeah.
Well, they should be.
Well, they have the monumental excuse of Adrian Newey, and apparently he's back in full payroll.
Adrian Newey, Max Verstappen, yeah. Danny Ricciardo. Yeah.
But interesting question: who will have the better car next year, Renault or Force India? I'm not sure.
Ooh. Question of the ages.
Who's
going to have the better car, Renault or Force India?
Oh, I think, oh man.
Okay.
I mean, Force India were way quicker in 2016, but that effectively counts for nothing next year.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, yes. Yeah, we're talking about complete, almost as complete of a clean slate that you can get, because we're talking about new groundbreaking aero regulations that are going to be introduced, as well as doing away with the token system. So on the engine side, things are going to be way different. I watched on Peter Windsor. Do you ever go on Peter Windsor's channel?
Yep.
Great stuff there. Scarbs, he was on, and he did a little 3-minute piece on why he believes that 2017 is going to be plagued with engine failures. And it's, to his point, it's basically saying, like, listen, some of these teams, now that they're free of, they're given free rein and with little on-track testing, we might see a team like Renault that out of desperation could choose to go on like a really on the limit and with completely new technology, and all of a sudden find that throughout the year they're going to have to like fine tune it and work on reliability.
Yeah. On that vein, Honda is rumored now to have split their turbo and compressor like Mercedes going into this season. So
they're gonna have to like make that work. They're gonna have to like make that work, and we're gonna see maybe some kind of breaking. Work.
That's like a restart. It's like starting over.
Yeah. So they might turn up with the 2014 Mercedes engine.
Yeah. and changes within Mercedes, changes within the top team, people leaving, and stuff. Yeah. So it's definitely gonna be like 2017 is gonna be a not necessarily a big reset, but let's call it like a half a reset at least of many variables. Definitely looking forward to that. Definitely looking forward to what Hülkenberg can do. Please, I mean, I was a big Hülkenberg fan. I'd love to see him actually, you know, prove everyone wrong or prove me wrong now, and go and do a fantastic job next year. But right now, as it looks, yeah, he's at the bottom of the list. Even so, you in your analysis, you say that Esteban Ocon even performed better than him. And that's another tall guy.
By the few races he competed, but
Ocon, see, he's exciting to watch though.
Yep.
Yeah, we're gonna really find out next year now. But.
Do you think it's is weird? Not necessarily weird, but are there any advantages or disadvantages to come to F1 via the DTM route like Ocon and Wehrlein did?
I think there's very little advantage to it. I think Mercedes is doing that with their drivers for their own interests, which is that DTM is important for them for marketing. I don't really see that the skills you would gain in that series of much relevance to Formula One. I really think a driver would be always better off in GP2 or World Series by Renault or even Super Formula.
Which is apparently like the next like testing ground. That's where they put Van Dorn. That's what Gasly's going to. Yeah. So.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be great if Super Formula was broadcast like, you know, in English?
Yeah, it's a little bit hard to watch those races.
I mean,
but they're usually pretty cool. I mean, those cars are quick, like seriously quick.
They're compared as the most downforce comparable, the most downforce relevant, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, they're slightly quicker than GP2 cars, I think, which makes them the next quickest thing after Formula One.
That's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
On a circuit, but they only race like 8 times a year or something. Great series.
Yeah.
I would like honestly that's just one. If I had, you know, like a list of New Year's wishes, that would be one for me. Like to be able to
drive one of those cars.
Well, I mean, geez, that's never gonna happen. But I'm too fat. But to be able to watch Super Formula, I think it would be great. I think all these little formula out there would do themselves a great service if they just like made the content available online the same way that the Formula 3 is doing. Just leave it. Anybody can watch it.
Yeah, they have a brilliant.
Yeah,
a brilliant structure. Yeah.
So it's moving on. K Mag next.
Yep.
4.5 points. Number 18.
Ahead of Ocon.
Destroyed his Palmer, his teammate. Yeah, ahead of Ocon.
Ahead of Ocon, below Wehrlein though.
Just.
Yeah, really not the season I expected from Magnussen. I thought he looked fairly respectable at McLaren. I mean, clearly Button had the edge, but Button is a very strong driver and experienced. So, you know, I thought really Magnussen would put away Palmer pretty easily, but he just didn't.
Absolutely. I think it's a big question mark, like, because I didn't also, even though I was disappointed, I didn't I couldn't pinpoint to you what exactly is that changed from when he was, but you know, he's just not as good in general, maybe, like he's just sort of turned it down. It's not like oh, he lost the grip of, you know, he's just not as good with the front end grip, he's just not as good in qualifying anymore. No, it's just like overall he's kind of slid down. It's too bad.
Yeah, I mean, it's a hard car image to judge a driver as well, because clearly that Renault was maybe the most difficult car to drive on the grid. It really didn't look good. You know, its handling wasn't stable. It just snapped between understeer and oversteer, which is pretty unusual these days.
Yeah, no doubt. Verline, another, like, a great season against Harianto. Like, there was absolutely no comparison there. Ocon, yep. when Ocon was put into the mix, I gave him a run for his money a bit, but still,
yeah, that was a good fight.
Yeah.
At first, it looked like Verline was going to handle it pretty easily, but by the end of the season, some of the stats were actually in Ocon's favor.
Forgive me again. I know this is unorthodox, but if you...
Yep.
Average the two scores for Harianto and Ocon, 3.09 and 4.46, you get a 3.76. And with Verline's 4.66, he beat them by, you know, 30% over the
season. Yeah, he beat them collectively, but that's largely done Harianto being much
more. Yeah, more Harianto, for sure, for sure.
Yeah. Verline, another great driver. But curiously, it seems like, or at least it seemed for a little bit, that Mercedes were putting maybe a little bit more of their money on Ocon, or on seeing Ocon move through the ranks.
Right.
Some people say that Verline's actual real life personality might have something to do with it.
He said that himself. We talked about that a couple weeks ago too. He admitted himself in an interview. He said, you know, like, I saw that he got along better with the team. I wasn't jiving with them. But there was also some sort of secret source headline that said from inside Renault that Verline didn't get the job because he didn't give up any Mercedes secrets. Somebody inside Renault, we talked about that too, remember?
Yeah.
I forget which magazine posted it, which magazine printed that, but that was another speculation, was that he didn't give Renault any Mercedes hints or secrets or tips about the engine, how they run it, how they set it up, or anything like that.
And honestly, we're talking again about, you know, like, it's sort of on the topic of the Renaults here and then Force India here, and who's going to be the better car next year. And I'm basing this, what I'm going to say, completely on, you know, broad and unbridled speculation. With absolutely zero base. You want, actually, hang on a second. Sorry. Do you want to get that mic?
Yes. You don't have to stop talking.
Though. Anyway, so on, just based on complete speculation and absolutely no scientific basis to this, I think that it's going to be Force India. Purely because Force India is probably going to just, you know, hunker down, keep doing what they're doing, keep their highly efficient aero program where they go and, like, instead of, like, spending months making something out of carbon fiber, they just do something that's approximate by 3D printing it, and that's what they bring to their wind tunnels, etc. You know, doing things the smart way and just working hard. Uh-huh. I think they're going to be able to do a little more than Renault, and I only say this because even though they are a works team, they're still French, and they're going to go around it the French way and try to do shit like that. They're going to try to be like, all right, what kind of secrets can you bring? How can we politicize this? How can we be French about this?
And you know, a bunch of them knew before we did about the French Grand Prix return.
Right.
Right. So there's pressure there to bring a French driver into the whole circus. Mm-hmm. You know, just like everything. Just like the
question
Brazilian...
is, does Verline have a seat next year?
Yeah, does he?
Because if Manor goes,
yeah, he might not. If Manor does not compete,
is that why they're keeping like the whole like announcement of the second seat at Mercedes so secret still? Because they didn't know what was gonna happen with Manor. Hey,
well, I mean, Bottas has always seemed like the natural pick for that seat, yeah. But then what does Williams do? Because I don't think they really want to run Wehrlein alongside Stroll, because then they've got two pretty inexperienced drivers. I mean, on the other hand, what's their alternative? Especially if Mercedes want to keep Wehrlein in the sport and Manor's gone.
I think it would be a mistake to bring Felipe Massa back, even though that's what it seems like they're doing.
They may do that.
It,
yeah.
it seems to.
But then Wehrlein is almost suddenly out of the seat.
Yeah, then what does he do?
Seems to have been semi-confirmed. They're going to pay Massa €6 million to compete next year, to come back, where he made four the year before. So 150% of his salary, of a €4 million salary. Is,
yeah,
insane.
But some of that money, like, let's be honest, if it actually ends up going that way, behind the curtains, some of that money is coming as some sort of a concession from Bernie, because we all know that Bernie is heavily invested in keeping a Brazilian driver on the grid. That's, everybody knows that.
And a British presence.
It makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah.
Keeping Williams happy and competing at the top, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Well, now that we're talking about Felipe Massa, so he was number 16 in your ranking.
Yeah, he's next.
For reasons that everybody can probably imagine, he didn't impress in his last season. I think that if he wanted to like leave the sport with some sort of dignity, he would have done so a couple of years back.
I mean, it was an okay season. It wasn't terrible. It wasn't great. Yeah.
Still, out qualified by Bottas, out raced by Bottas, points definitely, yep. You know, whatever, etc. We all know what happened with Felipe. 15, Danny Kvyat. Interesting season for him. It's a horrible start. Well, actually, yeah. Kind of okay start, horrible weirdness happening in the middle, and then he managed to like by the skin of the teeth show like a little bit of like, hey, hang on guys, I can still drive F1 at the very end.
Yeah. just barely. I'm surprised they've kept him for another year, really surprised, to be honest. I mean, they were unusually ruthless in the decision to demote him mid-season, but then they were unusually generous in deciding to keep him.
Yeah,
his girlfriend is so.
They're a little too harsh, and it needed to all balance out.
Yeah, Kvyat, he's still like, I don't know what to make of it ever, really, because he did, he finished that podium early in the year in China, right, and that was probably one of the best drives that he's shown, and it was so early on against Danny Rick, you know, it gave me a reason to cheer, right? And like tons of Russians were super excited. But then he went like the complete opposite end. So yeah,
he got a little depressed. Yeah, through the year for a little bit, for a couple of weeks.
Is he then one of those drivers?
He was a bit down.
And for that, like, and by that also like just sportsmen in general that just let their emotions completely rule how they're thinking and how they behave on the way they perform.
That's what sports psychologists are for.
I guess so.
Help you get over that feeling.
Well, yeah,
because it's such a big thing, and like, yeah. No, seriously, yeah. Such a prevalent thing in sports. Of
Grosjean did like 2 years with a sports psychologist, and his performance was actually better after.
Yeah. It's become a big thing in the last decade. Just getting over that. Your teammates pressuring you, your family, whatever it is, the media.
You're watching Game of Thrones. People call you. That throws your whole day in a completely different direction, I'm sure.
Grosjean's next, number 14.
Yep. I thought he started very strong. I mean, I started running the model predictions basically 5 races into the season. Mm-hmm. And at that point, he was around the top 6. You know, he had this very strong start to the season, and then he just fell and fell and fell throughout the season as he, you know, stopped scoring points, stopped beating Gutierrez as convincingly.
Yeah.
So like, he stopped, like, just below 30% below the grid, a third of the way below the grid, but the average, I guess. But
yep.
As a team, though, Haas was second last. They're last if you don't count Manor.
No, they were rated above those teams. Once you correct for drivers.
Oh, sorry. I'm doing the unorthodox adding the two drivers together.
Yeah, okay.
But driver performance wise, just Gutierrez.
So the model, let me just check. Yeah, so the model had Haas 6 just ahead of Renault and Toro Rosso.
Mike, can you pull up the
okay, so if you had the model. as far as drivers, and I know I'm probably making you want to pull your hair out. But yeah, it's last 7.59. Just Gutierrez pulled him down so hard for him to be able to shine. Like, both drivers, like, in reality, both drivers really have to do well to make the team shine as a whole.
Yeah, I agree. And unfortunately for Haas, like, there weren't many point scoring opportunities, but when they came, they were all of a sudden in with very good points, and Gutierrez just wasn't taking those chances for his Grosjean.
He's getting yelled at more than anything. But yeah, they admitted towards the end of the year that after they got those first points at the start of the year, they gave up on 2016 altogether. They just went straight to next year as soon as they got those points.
It might have been the smart move, though, let's be honest. This chart here, I found, like, genuinely quite interesting. It's the first one that you put in the on this year's model, in this year's model. We were talking about Grosjean, so this is when it comes to play. Yeah. And I think, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but that green line being the Paris line, it actually sort of reveals something that's sort of counterintuitive to what most people think. Like, he was, so his lap times get consistently longer and longer. Like, he's actually grinding through the tires more than people give him credit for.
Yeah, so just to be clear, this is from the Bahrain race.
Yes.
So these times are specific to that race. So yeah, in that race, Perez was really chewing through the super softs very quickly compared to Grosjean and Magnussen.
And
I mean, that's not necessarily true all the time. I haven't done that analysis for the whole season because I know Perez has his reputation of generally being pretty good on his tires. Mm-hmm.
But no, so that the fact that was so counterintuitive, and he was, and it's a race that, like, he didn't finish in a bad spot. Like, it still gives him, like, it goes to show that he can actually crank it when it comes to it. Like, he doesn't have the one style of driving. I don't know. I found that pretty interesting. The Magnussen line, like, again, showing how he compares to Grosjean and how Grosjean is just maybe, like, has a bit more of a soft touch. Or at least he did at that point. Interesting to see all this stuff. I mean, I love this stuff, man. You should do more of this.
I am actually working on an analysis. I managed to get some old testing data on Bridgestone tires. So I'm hoping to sort of get an idea of how they compare to Pirelli tires.
Oh, man.
Oh, wicked.
That would be sweet.
Cool.
Looking forward to that. There you go. You heard it here first. so now 13.
Down to 13, yeah. Number Magnus, yeah. I mean, Marcus Ericsson.
Ahead of Grosjean. And that.
Yeah.
So he's. I know that we talked about him before, like, we, you know, when we first started doing the podcast or something, and like how, despite his money, I guess, so there was, this would have been like when he first joined F1, he kind of joined F1 in. You know, with a big backing that people kind of didn't know where it was coming from, but he came with some money. But the speculation by some people, or some of what you read, is that aside from the money, he actually was, out of the people that joined when he joined, was probably one of the ones that had a bit of talent to back him up. And over the years, ever so, I mean, not in a like drastic way, but we have seen him getting better. His racecraft is better. He's more exciting to watch, and clearly he's got something going. And now he's got a ton of money from the Tetra Pak group, we know now, backing and basically buying Sauber.
Yeah, we went through that a couple of weeks ago. They're buying Sauber. Sauber is going to go with the old engine this year and revamp next year with the whole new chassis, engine, and car package. But don't want to forget that he went to the hospital about three times this year, at least twice. Don't forget, he crashed the car really bad.
Yeah.
I think, where was it, in Hungary maybe?
Yeah.
I think maybe in Hungary, he crashed the car really bad and he went to the hospital with a sprained arm. And then a week or two, maybe it was 3 weeks later, in one of the Asian races, he was training on his bike, doing some endurance running.
Q1 during Hungary, yes.
Yeah, so yeah, Hungary. In the first qualifying, he crashed, smashed the shit out of his car, didn't race that weekend. And then he went for a bike ride, one of the other Asian races. Sorry, I forget which one. But he crashed into a chicken when he was doing 35 or 40.
No. Didn't you hear? It was a man-eating crocodile.
Oh, crocodile.
No. That was just like people were being funny about it.
Yeah, he ran into a chicken. He rode over a chicken with his bicycle, flipped off of it, and broke his arm up.
Yeah, but it still doesn't mean that he's not F1 material, and nor that he won't continue to grow. Is he championship material?
I don't know. I think someone who's running into chickens, frankly, shouldn't be on the grid.
Yeah. You know, Vettel avoided those seagulls.
Don't forget. Exactly, right? Ability to avoid poultry is a critical.
Oh, man. No, but... but Ericsson... It's not like he shouldn't be in F1. He's not.
He had quite a good season, actually. And if you throw out Brazil, you can basically flip his and Nasr's ratings. Like he was sort of just outside the top 10,
right,
up until that.
Nasr only just beat him.
Well, Nasr just had that fantastic race in Brazil.
0.17 points.
Probably just the home advantage or whatever for him. First time, well, like second time. Racing in Brazil.
It was an interesting race for him. I mean, he basically didn't do a pit stop all race.
Yeah,
he was always on the right tire, essentially, and always taking pit stops when there was a stoppage.
So yeah, these two, Ericsson and Nasr, like within 2% their driver ratings.
Now we're talking about
super close.
One of the points that you made on your model is that we're talking about Manor and Sauber being basically like you compare them to being the same car roughly or whatever, same performance.
Yeah,
I think Manor now with a solid financial backing is a team that's definitely worth hanging on to if you want some sort of an F1 future, because if they have the money behind them, their facilities are for a team like that's at that end of the grid. They have their own wind tunnel. Not even Force India has their own wind tunnel. You know, like they have apparently very, very competent facilities thanks to the huge influx of money back in 08 or whatever with BMW before they pull off the sport. But those, like the stuff is still there. And if you have enough money to run it at full blast, you can probably chuck out a pretty good racing car if you have the right people.
I guess the issue is it's a good structure if you're going to run sort of a midfield or above team.
Right.
It's maybe the wrong structure for a backmarker team. Like maybe you are actually better off doing the Force India model where you don't own your own wind tunnel and have to maintain it. You just buy the time you need.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
But money, yes. This money that's coming to them, I think it could help them. Well, I mean, it might bring him back to the midfield, sort of where they were when Sergio Perez was racing for them. Remember that?
Remember Perez?
That was a good year for Sauber. Honestly, I'd love to see them going back to that. Yeah. what else do you got? Wait, sorry. Where are we now? So
next is Perez, number 12.
Hey, speaking of 5.57,
yeah. Beat Hülkenberg. Like we said earlier, beat Hülkenberg in the qualifyings. Not in the races.
I have a thing. I think since 2012, we've only seen one really bad year for Perez. That year that he went to McLaren, like it's like something happened. The pressure got to him. The fame got to him in a bad way, and like he just sort of stumbled. But if you cross that year,
also their first year together, Hülkenberg had the advantage over Perez.
Right, but he was finding his footing.
If you look at the 3 years all together, it's almost exactly tied.
Oh yeah, but they were both being good.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, I think
question is whether either of them can quite get to that next level.
Mm-hmm. I think I have better hopes on Perez doing better next year than Hülkenberg, but that may mean nothing. Right. That just you know. An F1 team, like I think it was Ross Brawn. And did you read his recent book with Adam Parr?
Parts of it. I haven't read the whole thing yet.
Yeah, pretty good so far, though, eh? So you know, one of the things that they were talking about is basically how it takes... It's not like an overnight thing. It takes like 3 years to all of a sudden like drive an F1 team in a completely different direction if that's what you want to do. If you want to, like, change the whole design philosophy, it's not just a thing that you can do overnight. So Hulkenberg, for him to be able to, like, really cash in on that move, he's going to have to wait. And that's just it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But Sergio Perez...
Well, I mean, on the other hand, sometimes when you have a big regulation change, mm-hmm. you know, one or two teams figure out something revolutionary that no one else does. Yeah. And then all of a sudden they get a big boost.
That's true.
You know, and we'll almost certainly see that next year. Some teams will figure something out and it will really upset the hierarchy. Mm-hmm. You know, it could be Renault, it could be anyone.
I hope it's not Red Bull. Can you imagine another...
It could be Red Bull, it could be Mercedes.
Can you imagine another era of Red Bull domination? I mean, as much as I like Danny Rick.
I think it would be more interesting with Ricciardo and Verstappen there than Vettel and Webber.
Yeah, true. Yeah, it would be.
Yeah,
it definitely would be. I'm sure you're rooting for Danny Rick, obviously.
I don't. I'm pretty neutral on that, to be honest.
On that team rivalship, like,
you don't want anyone to ask you to do a shoey in support.
I definitely don't want to do a shoey. I don't know. I get always put off by sort of very patriotic reporting of news. So if anything, it kind of biases me against Australian drivers.
Would you do a shoey though?
Under the right circumstances, sure.
Sweet. Now we got this. We got this live on the internet. The internet has seen that. We'll work on what the circumstances are and hold you to that later.
Nazar's next, number 11,
ahead of Perez, and this is what I like. One of the biggest shocks for me, because I didn't see that coming.
I think
difficult comparison to draw, really, because the Sauber was pretty shit this year.
Yeah,
you know, hard to know if you'd put them in equal machinery where they'd be. But yeah. That's the model's opinion.
I guess most of that over his teammate comes from just the points in the races.
It comes from Brazil. I mean, it's important to remember that the model does use this extended point system. So it doesn't only care about top 10 finishes. It is awarding points for 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, etc. You know, decaying down much the same way as the points do within the top 10.
That's why we're talking to you. Because it covers everybody. Yeah, which is
pretty- exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
So yeah, Nasser, but he did do a good job, and let's not forget that. So Nasser is interesting because he actually worked his ass off during the junior categories. He was actually he didn't come from massive money like some Brazilian drivers have done. Not a lot of massive sponsorship, but one key person that helped him along the way that spotted a talent was Kimi Raikkonen. He basically Kimi brought him under his wing and. Like, he was part of, like, Kimi Raikkonen's own, like, little junior talent management scheme that he's got going on.
Mm-hmm.
So Kimi clearly saw something there. So he's got some talent. He's definitely got a lot of work to do if he wants to be championship-winning material. But he's there.
Honestly, he also might not have a seat next year. So it might be a moot point.
Yeah. It's true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If Manor is going, there really aren't many available seats left for a whole bunch of drivers.
Yeah, at all, really.
Yeah.
Which takes us to number 10, Bottas.
So,
yeah,
this is where we start to get into the real and the serious drivers. And you start to see why Bottas has got that Mercedes seat.
Or if he does. It's not announced yet.
He does. But yeah, above Bottas are, you know, the people have really earned their seats.
Well, I mean, except for Jensen. Jensen finished 9 ahead of Bottas. I actually agree with this because whereas Bottas was great against Massa, Button was just like, he was just not only like just better overall, like in performance. If you could see that, like how if they had been in the same car, Bottas would have had a hard time going against Button. But also, Bottas, remember at the very beginning of the season how he just had a bit of a lull? Like I think he attributed to the back problems. He took a while to get rid of the back problems or whatever.
From the year before.
Yeah. But still, it's still
flew over those curves. Yeah. But as well, Button and Raikkonen this season ended up with the same number of points.
Raikkonen, what a season! Actually, that was one of the most uplifting news for me, because I've been a Raikkonen fan for a while, and then like sort of like by the third race this year, I was throwing the towel, man. I was like, oh man, Raikkonen, what are you doing, man? Like, what's going on? And then he like woke up and was like, boah, I guess I'm an F1 driver.
After his son popped out,
yeah, I guess so.
It was a pretty good season from Raikkonen. I was not expecting it. I thought we'd just see further decline, to be honest.
Yeah. But it turns out that after he had a kid, maybe he was just worried about his kid. Now, after the kid was out, he's like, all right, let's go back to this.
Well, maybe he's getting some sleep again.
Yeah, true.
Yeah. Rosberg, the foreshadowing of his retirement, his score was the devil's mark.
666. And he's number six driver.
He's the number six driver. Yeah. The whole thing, we should have seen it coming years ago.
He just wasn't an exciting driver to watch that much. I mean, not when compared to Lewis. He's not like a nice guy to like listen to interviews on. We even said, like, you know what, thank goodness that we don't really have to talk about him too much more now after he's retired.
Yeah, what do you want to say? The mark of Satan, he's got that red eye.
He puts pads, like lady sanitary napkins on his forehead. Did you hear about that?
Yeah.
Is that what he does?
Yeah, that's you didn't hear about this?
Maxi pads?
Yeah. So he puts sanitary napkins on his forehead to prevent all the sweat from. Yeah, man, this is. He came out and said that. He said that, not me.
I gotta say that from a technical side, I think he'd be one of the most interesting F1 drivers to have a one-on-one chat with, because I think he really understands the intricacies of what's going on.
Yep.
Well, as opposed to just being instinctively very good at driving.
He got accepted in an aerospace engineering program before becoming an F1 driver. Like, I mean, from high school, but still, like, I mean, you gotta be at least mildly technically minded to get.
He also topped the Williams engineering aptitude test for drivers.
Oh.
They give that to every driver as they come.
For a while. Actually,
interesting. Yeah, I didn't know.
That's pretty cool. And he speaks five languages. I think he has. I think he's looking forward to a very fruitful and successful career in the world of F1 as either a manager or some sort of presenter, or just like an overall paddock guy, like a guy that hangs around the paddock all the time.
You just work on subtitles in other languages. Who knows?
But. So I'm glad that he got that, and I'm glad that he got out when he got out. That's what I said before. I thought it was a classy move.
I saw it coming. It was a bit of a surprise for me. Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what he does from him. Whether he comes to visit the paddock or whether he just wants a clean break from F1. I don't know. Can imagine him in the Mercedes garage next year. Like, hey, Lewis, how's it going?
Yeah, hey, just poking. Hey, man.
How was qualifying, Lewis?
Remember when we used to be on the same team last year?
Yeah. Let me see your data. Come on. They're probably going to end up being like friends again. Honestly, like, it's just kind of like how, you know, when politicians shake hands after an election, it's like they're going to be fine together. And I think that as world champion, I'm not 100% on this fact, but as world champion, you pretty much get like a free pass to go to any race. Mm. And go to the paddock or whatever. So, like, that's a cool thing. I mean, he's got that for the rest of his life.
Sure.
Lewis Hamilton at sixth.
Actually,
Rosberg, I would say a little underrated, though.
Hmm?
I think a little underrated. I mean, because he had so many issues in qualifying.
Right.
And if you take those out, he was clearly the better performer than Rosberg.
Sorry, I said Rosberg. What? Ricciardo. Hamilton and Ricciardo, same score.
Yeah, sure. 6 points. Yeah, if you look at like second through about seventh, they're all very close ratings. Like, you know, race by race, as little things were happening, the order of those drivers was just churning constantly.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that. So Danny Rick and Hamilton.
In my view, both of those were fairly underrated. Reasons sort of laid out in the article. Ricciardo sort of had some unfortunate teammate comparisons, you know, with Kvyat just sort of losing the plot once he went to Toro Rosso.
Yeah.
You know, if it were down to just me, I'd probably put Ricciardo in my top two.
Okay.
I thought he had a really brilliant season. I mean, there were some bad spots early on in the battle against Verstappen. Mm-hmm. I mean, that battle was fairly close overall, but I'd say Ricciardo probably had a small edge. So really a very strong season from Ricciardo, I thought.
Mike, yeah. can you just pull this up just so we can the viewers can see it? So this just goes with what you were talking about.
Yep.
Yeah. It's that chart where you put like the driver's faces up and
down.
Oh,
yeah, yeah.
That's right there. Is that on the screen right now?
Yep.
So can you just talk us through like this chart and like it's because we're seeing Verstappen at the top of both of them, basically.
Exactly. So what the model does is it looks at the driver's point scoring rate for each team they race for across the year, averaged. Mm-hmm. And then from that, it derives a performance metric. So on the left-hand side, you have the driver performance metrics for Toro Rosso. Mm-hmm. And on the right-hand side, you have for Red Bull. So at Toro Rosso, Verstappen had clearly the highest scoring rate of any of the Toro Rosso drivers, ahead of Sainz and well ahead of Kvyat. Then if you look at Red Bull, so although Ricciardo slightly outscored Verstappen while they were teammates together, if you average across the whole season, mm-hmm. Verstappen comes out marginally ahead in points per race. And that's partly because the Red Bull improved across the season.
Yeah.
So he wasn't in Red Bull in the early part of the season when maybe it wasn't quite as good. He also jumped ship from Toro Rosso mm-hmm. when they started to go down. So Verstappen kind of got the best of both cars in a way. And the model, you know, assumes team performance is kind of stable within a season. Whereas in this case, you know, probably it was varying somewhat. So in that case, Verstappen kind of benefits from both of those comparisons. Ricciardo is hurt somewhat because he spent the whole season at Red Bull, and he probably faced a stronger version of Kvyat than Sainz faced at Toro Rosso, I would argue.
But and that is super interesting what you said, like how he kind of got the best of both cars, because it's true. Like as the Toro Rosso got locked with the old Ferrari engine that wasn't getting developed, they did start to slide back. And after they obviously must have realized that their time was better spent on designing this year's car, 2017, and then he moved to Red Bull as Red Bull like finesse the program. So that kind of stuff would probably, if you're like a fervent Verstappen fan, would give you like, you know, you wouldn't look at that. You wouldn't say that. You would just be like, just look at this. Look at how good he was. But you're not taking into consideration the fact that he had all that going for him. I found that interesting
and
as well.
Kvyat wanted to quit and he was crying and getting all depressed halfway through. just it wasn't working for him.
The top four.
I think there's a lot of uncertainty there. I mean, I'd be pretty comfortable saying Verstappen and Ricciardo are closely matched.
Yeah.
And Sainz is probably within that trio,
right,
also closely matched. As to their respective orders, I wouldn't be too confident.
Well, we'd have to see, like, wait and see what happens this year. That's gonna be great.
Yeah, exactly. We need more data. We always need more data.
Yeah.
Number four is
top four now.
Vettel.
Mm-hmm.
7.21 points.
A lot of people were pretty unhappy with Vettel being that high in the ratings. Maybe he is slightly overrated, or more that Hamilton and Ricciardo were both kind of underrated by the model. But actually, you know, Vettel's season was a little better than it looked on paper. Like, he did actually have a clear edge against Raikkonen.
Yeah.
He had more bad luck than Raikkonen. That's definitely true.
Yeah.
On the other hand, he didn't have the kind of advantage over Raikkonen that he had last year when he topped the rankings. And certainly nothing like the advantage Alonso had over Raikkonen the year before that.
Yeah.
So whether that's down to Raikkonen improving or Vettel getting worse or some combination thereof, I'm not really sure.
Vettel also, I mean, he kind of, I don't know if this was, well, of course it was, aided by Ferrari strategy mishaps. But he kind of did start, like, to, as those became more frequent, he himself kind of started to drop the ball a little bit. Like, a little bit.
Yeah, he seemed to kind of lose patience. I mean, there were a lot of what I thought were fairly sloppy errors throughout race weekend sessions from Vettel that we're not normally seeing. Mm-hmm. He was clearly getting pretty agitated over the radio.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, guys.
Honestly, what are we doing here?
And so, I mean, Vettel, like, what else can we say about him? Like, we've basically been talking about his, you know, fall from grace. I mean, and still, at fourth, even though it's a pretty decent spot, and like you said, some people are telling you, like, you know, why did he end up so high? Still, to me, this is still not where a four-time world champion should be. So, I mean, really, I mean, he should be higher just from that, but he's not. So, that's right. there's something there. And he did have bad luck, but...
He did have bad luck, but even when you correct for that and you look at the time differences, the advantage he had in terms of lap times in races and qualifying over Raikkonen, it was much smaller this year than last... Oh, in 2016 than 2015.
Yeah. Hey, Mike, sorry, can you change the scene so we can see all of us?
Is that number three, Carlos Sainz.
I thought you were a fan.
7.26 points per race.
Yeah. Thought it was a very impressive season from Sainz.
Everybody's been saying that.
Yeah.
I wasn't predicting him to be quite that strong. I thought his racecraft was really fantastic.
Yeah.
And he just demolished Kvyat. I mean, even, you know, even if Kvyat was not at his best or emotionally affected, I mean, that was one of the most one-sided teammate matchups I've seen in a while.
Yeah, I was going to say, in the first four races against Verstappen, he wasn't doing as well. Against Kvyat, he smashed him the whole rest of the season. 16 more races, 17 more races.
This is something that Peter Windsor used to say. Like, he started the year when he was talking about the different drivers and whatever. Like, back then it was obviously Verstappen and Sainz in the same team.
Yeah.
And then he was talking about Danny Rick and Kvyat at that time. And he kind of compared the two Red Bull owned teams, and he said something to the vein of, like, you know, it's kind of like they have this arrangement where they have a top driver that, and then he saw that so he was talking about Ricciardo and then Verstappen in Toro Rosso as the drivers that drive very smoothly, very just very smooth drivers, as opposed to their counterpart, who was very corrective, very driving, like, you know, doing this kind of thing, as opposed to like one fluid movement. Obviously he's generalizing, but he was trying to, like, say how some teams kind of have that kind of dynamic in between the two drivers, going one that can do like the smooth, like talented kind of natural driving, whereas the other ones that are just more violent, more reactive. He wasn't giving a preference to any kind of driving. He was even saying that, like, they both work if you can make him work. But then when the dynamic, I guess, got crisscrossed, and then you saw in his eyes, I guess, in the Red Bull, two smooth drivers, and then in the Toro Rosso, two corrective drivers.
Right.
You did see how Carlos Sainz was definitely, if anything, out of that pair, like, definitely the better corrective driver.
Right.
And when you see him drive, and especially those drives that he had in the rain, you just see how, no matter how smooth you are, like, just the fact that Sainz is always having to think on his feet and always looking for where to attack, that helped him a lot, and that was brilliant to see. I wasn't necessarily a Carlos Sainz fan before 2016, but towards the end I definitely was.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's something I liked 100%.
Question is, what will happen next year between them, with Sainz and Kvyat? Because the cars should be very different to drive.
Yeah.
We'll see how it suits the different stuff.
Those big ass tires. Do you think there's any truth to, like, the fact that, so another thing that Peter Windsor was saying, in a way, was that these big tires and just the more mechanical grip is gonna give drivers that are corrective, you know, the guys that are dancing with the car, not necessarily an advantage, but it's gonna give them more ways to approach a corner, if that makes sense, you know, the guys that are going to be throwing the car around.
Maybe. I don't know. I feel like it's easy to make a lot of predictions like this, and then often they don't come true and everyone forgets.
Charlie, what our podcast is about.
Yeah. That's exactly what we're banking on.
So number two here, Max Verstappen.
Okay, yeah.
7.26 points per race.
Couldn't have asked for a better. For I mean, he wasn't a rookie, but come on, after he found his footing in Formula One, like, I guess this was the year where, like, we believed the hype, we believed the Max Verstappen hype.
Yeah, pretty
spectacular. Yeah, I mean, certainly not a perfect year, but for someone so inexperienced, yeah, pretty phenomenal.
Why don't you take the last one? Since
yeah, well, do you think that says anything negative about the sport? The fact is, this has been, since he joined, this has been the thing, and some people are still harping on about it. What's his name? Jacques Villeneuve even, like, say, it's just not good. Like, to some people, it's just not good that these young people are coming to the sport and somehow being able to, finish number two in your standings. Is it something that's intrinsically by itself bad for the sport?
I don't think so. I think it probably actually boosts the sport's popularity. But I can see where that argument is coming from. I mean, on the one hand, you could argue it gives the perception that the cars are too easy to drive.
Yeah.
When you've got this kind of, skinny teenager comes in having never driven anything with more than 200 horsepower and he's just fine. Clearly the cars are more stable these days than they have been in the past. There's not as much going on in the cockpit. Like, yeah, people are pressing lots of buttons, but, we don't have manual gear shifting or anything like that. We have power steering. I mean, that didn't exist in the past. Yeah. I'd like to see Verstappen handle the car with no power steering. I think that would be interesting.
Especially the 2017s with the bigger tires.
Yeah. So there is that. And then I guess there's also the fact that he kind of came in and he upset the status quo with respect to racecraft.
Yeah.
He seemed to be doing things very differently. It led people to say, has the sport become so staid, that everyone is just sort of driving within a particular formula? Mm-hmm. And then, if someone else comes in with a new idea, mm-hmm. it's kind of a revolution all of a sudden. So, why were others not attempting these things?
Because, I think one of the headlines that really stuck to me was Max Verstappen has exposed the Formula One groupthink. That was a headline that came out. And the article was basically like just not necessarily like attacking, but really highlighting the fact that there is sort of a racing indoctrination that you go through. Like, with, I guess, like many, like in any kind of human endeavor right now, if you choose to like go up the ladder, there are like, you'll find people along the way that will tell you, you have to approach a corner this way, in terms of single seaters and whatever. And to drive like the most out of the car, you have to do this. But yeah, and then comes in this guy with very little experience that's willing to try something else and show everybody that, no, you don't necessarily have to do that. Very cool. Very good to see. Great story.
I've got to say, it's definitely not the first time that's happened. I really felt like I was watching Schumacher in 94 and 95 again. Yeah. Very similar sorts of movements in braking zones and things, really pushing things to the limit. I think really what Verstappen exposed most is that we don't have consistent rules of stewarding in a lot of these cases.
That's a big one.
Yeah, that's huge.
Yeah.
It's that does the thing that needs to change, but when anything goes to the FIA level and how they enforce stuff, then it becomes politicized. I think that I agree with Martin Brundle. We have the technology right now to automate a lot of that and like get rid of the gray area, and it's baffling that F1 hasn't chosen to do that.
It's equally baffling that those data aren't used to improve the broadcast, though.
Right.
Like, yeah. I mean, why not show a graphic of, these were the lines all these drivers just took through this corner. This was their speed at each point in the corner. Oh, look, this driver was 2 kilometers per hour faster at the apex.
They did
this
some driver sort of
took a later.
Yeah,
that would be fascinating. This driver broke, got on the brakes 2 meters later.
They did that like 3 times actually this season. They showed some sort of a graphic on, at least on the Sky broadcast, of like where people were braking. So they clearly have, and this was an FOM graphic. So they have the technology to do that. Yeah, why aren't they doing that for everything? Or well, not everything, but you know,
there's so much you could do there, just to get people more engaged. Because especially if you're a new fan to the sport, all those subtleties are not immediately obvious, right? You have to watch the sport for a long time to even pick up whether a driver's on a hot lap or not. Like, that's not immediately obvious to someone who just switches on the TV.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
yeah.
The sport has...
Anyway, I'll stop ranting, but that's sort of a point I really would like to see address.
Absolutely.
No, I think it's valid. I feel like I can see those decimals of a second after years and years.
Yeah, only after years and years, and only after kind of people have pointed it out to you, or like you know you might get to like notice it. But yeah, if somebody was pointing it out to you, like, hey, listen, look at how he did this, look at where he braked, make him just more digestible for anybody.
Yeah.
Number one on the analysis on what got you that the infamous tweet was obviously Fernando Alonso coming first with 7.92 PPR. The model figured out that, as far as we're concerned, the driver that really put it all out there, and if this was a stock series with everybody with the same car, we might have seen a championship won by a Fernando Alonso.
Yep.
Wait,
that's
what
it looks like.
I'm an Alonso fan, so I'm going to remove myself from the conversation. Because anything that I say is completely biased. I have no way to hide it. It'll be completely biased. But yes, Alonso, best driver in the grid by far. Come on.
So, I think at this moment, you know, I have to confess that I'm just an Alonso fanboy, that I built the model just to show that Alonso is the greatest driver of all time. You know, it's been clear for a long time, and now I think it's undeniable.
Going by the method I keep mentioning, the unorthodox method of adding the two drivers for a team to get a individual score, I just want to point out McLaren comes first, Red Bull second, Ferrari, Mercedes, Toro Rosso, Manor with an asterisk. They would come in sixth, yep. Williams, and then Force India, Renault, and Haas. Down and then
yeah, so that's sort of a good metric. What you're doing is basically telling you what's the sort of quality of the drivers of the team, basically, on average.
The driver in the team, yeah.
The drivers.
Yeah. If you run the model by the driver sort of doing team, the reverse, yeah. If you assume all the teams had equal drivers and sort of run the Constructors' Championship that way, I ended up with the following ordering. It was Mercedes in first, of course, Red Bull, Ferrari, Force India, so that all followed the Constructors' Championship, Williams. Then Haas, Renault, and then Toro Rosso and McLaren were about tied. Ooh. And then Sauber and Manor roughly tied.
Huh. Which is sort of where they, like, if you really think about it, that's sort of where they were. I mean, not by the numbers, but that's, if you think about it.
They're very close.
That's where they, anyway, you think about it. There.
Yeah. We have a few questions from the chat.
If
we have time for that, that'd be...
Oh, actually, yeah, Andrew, like, we've taken up a whole chunk of your time. Are you cool with staying on for a little longer?
Yeah, sure. Let's chat a bit longer.
Yeah.
All right, cool. All right, so we have one question from Byron. I know you talked about it earlier very slightly, but Byron asks, can I have your thoughts on the removal of the token system for next year?
I think it's a good thing.
Okay.
Because I think at this point, Mercedes has kind of a cemented advantage. Yeah. And the best thing for the sport is probably to allow Ferrari and Renault, and Honda especially, to make some inroads.
Yeah.
It'd be bad for costs, but I'm not even sure I buy that argument, because you know, the manufacturers are still spending. They're just spending within this bizarre constraint.
Yeah. No, it was completely ridiculous. It was brought in to rein in the costs, and if anything, it did zero for that. People were just spending their money elsewhere, like you said. Do we have any other
fans? Yeah, I just got one more. This is from Leston Davis. My question is about the progress of integrating age and experience into the model. It sounds like it could be a great improvement, almost a definitive model when compared to the others.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's really where these models need to go next. So I did a post earlier this year sort of summarizing the three models that exist. One of which is mine, another which was published this year, and another which was published a few years back. And, you know, the models agree in certain cases and disagree in others, which is interesting in its own right. But sort of the fact that all of the models are missing at the moment is the effects of age and experience. And when I do sort of look at the data after having fit the model, it's clear the drivers on average perform much worse in their rookie year and a little bit worse in their second year than they do in later years of their career. And also, as you'd expect, there's something of an age trend. So drivers tend to be around their peak from something like 25 to 35 years old, with, you know, tailing off at either end. And currently the model isn't considering that. And I think that's really important in terms of some of the all-time rankings. Mm-hmm. Because for instance, Nico Rosberg, when he faced Michael Schumacher at Mercedes from 2010 to 12.
Oh, he was...
He was ahead. And the question is how much of that was down to Schumacher's age, mm-hmm. the fact that he had, you know, a few years off as well. So those are the factors I'm adding to the model at the moment. I'm looking at a slightly different structure at the moment, a mixed effects model, it's called, where I take into account the effects both of how much experience the driver has, what age they are currently, and I'm also trying to look at what happens if a driver is away and then comes back, because it looks to me as though that also has a significant effect. It's just a question of how all these factors fit together. Because if I look at the age curve just for young drivers, just for drivers who started the sport early versus the age curve for drivers who started the sport late, like in their late 20s or later, the age curve is actually quite different. Drivers who start young tend to peak earlier and also tend to decline earlier, which is kind of counterintuitive, this early decline. So potentially these factors relate to one another. And one of the sort of greatest challenges actually is how do you treat 1950? Because technically all the drivers in 1950 were rookies in the Formula One World Drivers Championship because it didn't exist before then. But, yeah. Of course, many of them were racing in Grand Prix from the 20s or the 30s. Yes. You know, they had a lot of experience before. That's and then many of them had a big gap across World War II. Mm. In terms of how you actually model this consistently across all the eras is sort of the challenging point. But, yeah, I'm working on it. I'm hoping that will be finished this year.
Cool.
Awesome. And we've got one more question. It's sort of like a question of mine, too.
Sure.
Another one from Byron is like, he says, who would you like to see in the second Merc seat?
Oh, man, that's what, like, I was going to get into that, man. I was getting into that.
So, yeah, how about
a follow up question to that? I mean, please answer that. But a follow up question to that would be mine, and I'll tack it on. How brilliant would it be to see Alonso and Hamilton? And who would win, just from pure passion, perspective? Come on,
the numbers.
That one would be amazing. I think it could clearly go either way. Ricardo would be another one I'd really like to see.
Yeah.
Because he's sort of consistently, you know, he's sort of in the top three and not, mm-hmm. because the sort of canonical top three is Alonso, Hamilton, Vettel, mm-hmm. which is partly based on championships.
Yeah.
But then there's sort of the caveat that Ricardo, a lot of the time, looks just as good. And beat Vettel the one time they faced each other. Yeah. So is he more rightfully in the top three? I don't know. It'd be great to see him against one of those other drivers, either Hamilton or Alonso. And I think stylistically it'd be super interesting to see him against Hamilton because they're both sort of very late breakers, very, very aggressive in their racecraft, very incisive. I think that'd be an amazing matchup.
Nice.
God damn.
Can we pull up that link? Just the
Unfortunately, the we're not going to see that. So thank you.
Yeah, no. Oh, yeah, it's too bad. So what link do you have? I got something like just off of F1 or sort of.
That's just what we're still talking about.
Okay, all right.
Just because we were just talking about this. But it's fairly obvious this is the dude. It's Bottas. You can see it.
So it's not official yet, though, right?
No, it's not. It's, they're really, really waiting until the last second. Come on.
I just took this off Reddit. Somebody put something about his patience.
He's got to
start patient. Calling him Valtteri Robottas. That's his new name.
Can I just like pull it outside of F1 for just one second? And really not I'm not trying to like hog your time here, Andrew, but in your research right now, like, you know, you are Dr. Phillips for a reason. You spend your day job. You are a researcher of some sort, I'm assuming, because you're a PhD. And I was looking through the stuff that you that you're doing now, and I don't know if this is exactly what you're doing now, but you're working on sleep patterns.
Yeah, largely. I study sleep and circadian rhythms using mathematical modeling.
That's amazing. Because earlier in the year, one Danny and me and Mike, we were talking in our podcast about how Lewis apparently got this guy to train him around how to best focus his sleep pattern to be able to get the most out of each Grand Prix weekend, since they're just jumping back and forth through time zones and whatever, and like you know what I mean. Like, do you have any insight on that? Like, in terms of what you research? Obviously, I don't know anything about what you're actually studying.
Yeah, but so actually, some of the people I've worked alongside have developed methods for optimizing how you should schedule your sleep and your light patterns to transition across a time zone most quickly. So that, I would say, has obvious applications in Formula One.
Absolutely. You
know, for personnel and for drivers who want to sort of transition, because they are constantly jumping between time zones. I'm not sure that all drivers are necessarily taking advantage of that kind of thing. It certainly sounds from some tweets and things like they're not.
if you were, I mean, knowing what you know, if you were either an F1 driver or if you were somebody that an F1 driver was, you know, you were advising an F1 driver, like, what, like, how would you play it? Like, just out of curiosity, from what you know, like, let's say you know somebody that's an F1 driver and you have this great advice for them in terms of their sleeping. Like, what would you tell them to do?
Well, ideally what you do, especially with respect to jet lag, mm-hmm. is you take into account all of the existing commitments they have, things that can't be moved, mm-hmm. and then you'd schedule around that. So basically you'd have certain constraints on your model, mm-hmm. and then you'd figure out what's the optimal light pattern. It's basically a control theory problem. That would then shift them most quickly. I mean, even without a mathematical model, you can provide sort of basic advice on, you know, what light is going to do to you at different times of day, you know, how sleep should be structured, what is a good duration of sleep, what is your current level of sleep debt. So that's one area in which I work, is modeling the effects of sleep debt on cognitive performance.
Cool.
And that's definitely going to be something big in Formula One.
Yeah.
Because we know, you know, it's such fine margins between the top drivers. Something as little as an hour or two extra of sleep, mm-hmm. you know, could really translate on the track. Like, we know if you lose sort of half a night of sleep, you're sort of performing at a level as though you're at a fairly high blood alcohol concentration. You know, if you're awake for a full 24 hours, yeah. You're actually performing as though you're at about 0.08, so around the legal wow. limit for driving in the US. Well, we know that has a huge performance, a huge effect on performance, right? Like, no driver would turn up to a Formula One race drunk.
No.
not even James Hunt. Like, James Hunt would always abstain from alcohol.
Well, that's why he
in the week
before
of a Grand Prix.
Yeah.
Maybe a
cigarette. Yeah, he might have been using other things, enhancers potentially. but the idea of using alcohol at a Grand Prix would just be crazy. Whereas I'm not sure sleep is taken quite as seriously, but, you know, we know the sort of performance decrements are similar. I was only half joking when I said, you know, Raikkonen might be getting better sleep now that his kid's a little older.
but it's true, and it helps. So, and you said something about, so light, like, light is important.
Absolutely. So the body's circadian clock is most responsive to light. So in terms of getting it to transition to a new time zone, so mm-hmm. that it's aligned with where you would like it to be. So you're sleeping at the right time and you're alert at the right time of day. Mm-hmm. Getting it shifted using light is the most effective method. And light at certain times of day will either help or hinder you.
Oh, wow. Now actually, just another, like, to that, because I saw it on the other day. I like most people, like a lot of people, I do my stuff during the day. And then it's not only till, like, when I'm actually lying in bed, like, that I, like, have, like, a little bit of, like, you know, brain left over, that I go on Reddit, I open up Reddit, and I start scrolling through that, and at that time, and then it's on Reddit, actually, then I saw that it's actually, it can really throw your entire situation off if you're, like, all of a sudden exposing yourself to all of that light. And somebody suggested that what you're supposed to do is get this app that cuts out everything but the blue light, or something like that.
Yeah, screen filter on my phone.
Yeah, that is definitely beneficial.
Absolutely.
F-Lux is the program for computers.
F-Lux.
Yeah, because the circadian clock is very responsive to blue light, particularly.
Oh, interesting.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. There you go. I think it actually affects your nearsight too, doesn't it? Your nearsightedness?
Over time,
it affects your nearsightedness. The blue light?
Yeah, that probably might help.
We got one more question. It's just from Reddit. When will our Formula One be looking for a new mod to join the team? this is from Byron.
As an introduction to that, if everybody that's listening doesn't know, Andrew, you are a moderator
of the
Formula One subreddit. On top of everything else that you do, miraculously, you have time to do that. Honestly. Like, any Yeah, well, let's start with that question. So yeah, as a mod,
yeah, we are actually discussing that at the moment. So there may be a call for mods coming up.
There you go, Byron.
Cool.
Put your application in.
Start cozying up to the mods. and the community itself, just, I guess, I mean, geez, like, let's not take more of your time, but as a last question, the community itself as a whole has been growing. Like, it has skyrocketed. I've seen, like,
It's been fantastic. It's gotten very big. It was a big part of getting me sort of more engaged with Formula One again and talking with other people. Certainly when I was sort of first watching Formula One, there was nothing like that. You know, you'd watch the race with some friends or family, and you know, now and then you'd see a Formula One fan and have some brief conversation, and that was
God, you're into Formula One? I didn't even know.
Right. Yeah. So to have an actual hub like that is really cool, and it is definitely growing, and now we've got two Formula One teams on there as well, which is pretty neat.
Oh yeah, Sauber and who else again?
Renault
and Force India.
Fourth India. Yeah. and I'm sure it's been like a great experience, like lots of good stuff. After the 100,000 members, like since then, it was like it just kept going and going. And what is it at now? 130, 40, something like that.
Yeah, something like that. And I think Verstappen's helped a lot this year, actually.
Us two, man. Like, all of a sudden, viewership from the Netherlands. Dutch people. Oh, man. Good stuff.
Definitely getting a lot more hits from the Netherlands these days than I used to on F1Metrics.
Yeah, you noticed it, too?
Yeah, definitely.
I guess on that, thank you. First of all,
thank you for your time. Thank you for being so dedicated to this data. It's amazing.
And for all the work that you do on F1Metrics, your own research, I'm sure, and moderating the F1 community. Great job.
Oh, well, yeah, thanks for running the podcast. It's a lot of fun.
And I guess, can we say it's fair that we'll do another one of these later on?
Absolutely.
A mid-season review.
Post-season review? As time allows, of course. And obviously, when you introduce your new model, we'd love to hear all about it.
Yeah, that would be great.
Also, slight hint here, Flatto Fever is looking at introducing its own model. Perhaps we could...
We'll run it by you. Don't
perhaps
worry.
We could recruit you for some sort of look over.
Yeah, let's,
some
let's
sort talk. Of review.
We'll talk. All right.
Discuss its integrity. I'm not sure.
Dr. Andrew Phillips, F1 Metrics.
You what the fat?
F1 statistician extraordinaire. Great contributor to the community. PhD, honestly, we couldn't thank you enough.
Australian.
And above all, in my books, Alonso fan.
Thank you. Fan. Born an Alonso fan. Friend of Flatto. Yeah. All right.
Thank you so much, man. Take care.
See you. Take care.
Cheers. Bye.